How's everybody doing this morning? Great. It's a beautiful day on the first Sunday of October. You know what that means? Communion, right? Hey, look, there's communion. We have communion afterwards, which will be announced, so make sure you stay tuned for that. Let's all stand up together and just bow our heads and thank God for this beautiful Sunday of the first Sunday of October. Thank you, Lord, for beautiful weather. We thank you for this day where we come and worship you, Lord. We are so glad to be among you today. We just ask that you would bless this time as we come to pour our hearts and minds and souls to worship you this morning. Bless this day, Lord. Bless everything that happens in this building, Lord, and Agape service and the Arabic church service, Lord, that everything that we do here would just be all lifted up for your glory. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's worship together.
Searching for, we want you and nothing more. Let your glory fill this place. We're alive in your presence.
Sing one more time.
It's your heart we're searching for. We want you and nothing more. Let your glory fill this place. We're alive in your presence.
Alive in His presence.
We surrender all to you. Do what you want to. Do what you want to. God, we long to see you move. Do what you want to. Do what you want to. We are standing. Do what you want to, do what what you want to, God, we long to see you move. Do what you want to, do what you want to, surrender all to you. Do what you want to, do what you want to, God, we love to see you move. Do what you want to, do what you want to, all consuming fire.
Prayer today that the fire of the Lord would fall on us in His presence. Amen.
From the highest throne to the earth below, lay down your life for the sake of us. Great is the love of the Savior. From the wounded heart to the life made whole, every human heart will declare as one. Great is the love of the Savior. Lord of endless light, let your glory shine forever. Your praise. From the mountain clouds to the valleys low, all created things given life to show. Jesus, we live for your glory.
From the rising sun,
from the rising sun to the still of night, every waking moment for your delight. Jesus, we live for your glory.
We're here to glorify Him.
Lord of endless light, let your glory shine forever. All the earth will sing your praise. Hope of every heart, let your God be exalted, God be exalted in everything. We live for your glory, live for your glory. God be exalted, God be exalted in everything. We live for your glory, live for your glory. Your glory shine forever. All the earth will sing your praise. Above every heart, let our heart be lifted higher. All our hearts will sing your praise. And God be exalted, God be
we're here to glorify Him. We were made, we were created to glorify Him. That's our purpose. That's why we're here. Not to make money, not to have good lives, but to glorify Him and His mission. Amen? How many people believe that this morning? Amen. 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 Amen.
Old things have passed away. Your love has stayed the same. Your constant grace remains the cornerstone. Things that were thought were dead, breathing in life again. You caused the sun to shine on darkness night. For all that you've done, we will pour out your love. This will be our anthem song. Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Hopeless have found their home. The orphans now have.
Completely to you, Lord. May you pour out your love, Lord and Spirit, to us this morning. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Praise God. God is good. Amen. God is good. Amen. God is good. Amen. Amen. I love when the church talks. Praise God. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Amen. Bless the Lord. It's a great honor and privilege to be here with my family here, my Arab family, Christian family, and my real family. Oh, the kids disappeared again. I forget. Well, God is good. You know, I think I shared one time I was on a flight going, I believe it was Malawi in Africa, and had a bunch of college students with me. And I remember during the flight, I was toward, in the section we were seated, I was towards the front of that section, and the last three rows or so were all the college students. And of course, where there's students, there's noise. And too far for me to talk with them, but I could hear them nonetheless. And what got my attention during the flight, this gentleman started speaking with them. He was standing in the aisle, and he was either from Ireland or Scotland. He had one of those really neat accents. And he was very loud, had just a great personality. But during the flight, I could tell, even though I couldn't hear what the students were saying, one or some of the students, it was apparent they started to witness to him about Jesus. Well, how did I know that? Not from them, but by his response. And I can tell he was kind of almost putting down the Christian faith. And after a while, just hearing his part, it almost like he was dominating the conversation. I got a little restless, and I got up out of my seat, and I walked down the aisle. And I said, "Excuse me, my name is Salim." And the students knew what was about to take place. And I started to explain to him the gospel of Jesus Christ. I don't want to say we got into an argument, but we were fairly, I guess we were both pretty loud because, I thought he was going to give me money. Sorry, guys. Did I know who to call for? Are we good? Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Hello, hello.
Oh, hold on.
Thank you, Jesus. Y'all remember I'm on a plane, right? Good. Thank you, bro. No problem. And I noticed that everyone around was kind of watching us. So I mean, I clearly explained the cross and why Jesus had to come. I figured if he wasn't going to get it, the rest of the plane is right there. And I'm on this side, and I never saw her, but I guess she tried to get my attention. The stewardess came up from behind, and she actually poked me in the side. And because I guess I couldn't hear when she was talking. And I turned. Now, she's this close to me, and she said, "Excuse me, sirs, gentlemen, could you please be seated? The whole plane can hear you." And I was thinking, that's great. You know, I didn't say. And she's this close to me. And now, when this encounter takes place, all you hear now are the roars of the engines, because nobody's speaking. They're watching this. And she's this close to me, and I ended up, something came up out of me, and I spoke at the top of my voice. I said, "I just want everyone to go to heaven. Is there anything wrong with that?" And she goes, "No, that's fine, sir." She said, "But do they have to go right now?" You know, she was quick, okay? And now watch. If I ask how many want to go to heaven, I believe we'd all raise our hands. If I ask how many want to go right now, okay, we'd have some spiritual hands. Or maybe your students have tests tomorrow. I understand. But I'd be in church singing, "Lord Jesus, come quickly." And in my heart, I'd go, "What? Not right now, Jesus. Not right now." And I'm ready. I mean, I'm ready. So I thought, what is that? I'm so ready to go. But there's a hesitation of going this moment. And as I sought this out, the Lord told me, it's because, watch this. If there's a hesitation in your heart, you know what that means? God's not done with you. Listen, when God created us, he created us for a divine purpose, a divine destiny, a divine assignment. Paul says it like this in Acts 20. He said, "In order that I might finish my course." He knew God had a plan and a course for his life, because later in his life, he writes to Timothy, "I finished my course. I've run my race. I kept the..." So he knew when God was working, and he knew when God was done. And the psalmist in 139 said, listen to how David says in New Living Bible, he says, before I ever began to breathe, God scheduled every day of my life. So I like to say it like this. If you're still breathing, God's not done with you. Amen? I mean, one of the first things I do when I wake up in the morning, I breathe. Oh, God still has a plan for my life. So if you're still breathing, would you just kindly wave to me? Okay, turn to your neighbor. You're going to talk now. Say, God ain't done with me. Now with a smile, say, thank God he's not done with you. No. So watch, God has an assignment, a plan, and we're going to go somewhere this morning. It may be a little challenging, but I believe encouraging. Because how do you know what God's plan and purpose for your life is? How do you know where, I found with Paul, it's very interesting. And because you're going to see how voices will rise up, and maybe even godly voices, to get you off God's purpose for your life. Is that possible? Well, we'll see. But I've learned something. If you stay on the plan and purpose God has for your life, you may encounter obstacles, threats, persecution, adversity. However, if you stay on that course, God provides, watch this, supernatural protection and supernatural provision for you to finish God's plan and purpose for your life. Because unfortunately, 1 Corinthians, I know Paul's writing about communion and because where there's no unity, but it's interesting. He says, for this reason, some are sick, some are weakly, and some sleep or die early. Well, I don't want to die early. I want to finish my course. Amen? I mean, even martyrs, I believe, finish their course. Jesus stood to receive Stephen. Paul finishes his course before he's beheaded, but he finished. So John the Baptist finished his course. If you read Stephen's preaching, his message, even though it seems like he died. Listen, we don't know when that is, but I want to finish. How many of y'all want to finish? Yes? Okay, so watch this. I don't want to get too off track, so I jotted down a few notes. In John chapter 21, at the end of the Gospel of John, Jesus has already been resurrected. He has appeared to the disciples twice. Now he's appearing for the third time to the disciples, the ones that are here. What happened is Peter said, hey, I'm going fishing. And so six of the guys went with him. So they go, they fish all night. And early that morning, there's someone on the shoreline said, y'all catch anything? Well, it was Jesus. It was too far. They didn't know it was Jesus. He said, I guess Jesus was from Texas because he said, y'all. Anyway, that's strange. So what? He said, did y'all catch anything? And they said, no. He said, well, throw your net out on the right side of the boat. Well, they throw their net out on the right side, and there was such a great haul of fish. And John, who's pretty quick, he says, that's the Lord. And so Peter girds himself, and he jumps in, and Peter swims to shore. They bring the boat. They're just about 100 yards away. They bring the boat in, and it's interesting. Jesus already has bread and fish cooking, okay? And he says, bring me some of the fish. They happen to catch 153 fish. I'm not sure why that number's in there, but I know it's for a reason. But nonetheless, but watch this scene. They're eating, and then you know the dissertation where Jesus says, Peter, do you love me? Oh, yes, feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? Feed my lamb. Peter, do you love me? And, you know, Jesus can love. And then it doesn't say, I have a feeling they finished eating, and now they're just going for a little walk down to Galilee. Watch this scene. And it's like Jesus and Peter are arm in arm. The disciples are close by, just strolling. And then Jesus turns to Peter, and watch what he says. He says, Peter, when you were younger, someone dressed you and took you. Oh, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and you went wherever you wanted to go. When you are older, someone else will dress you. Watch this. And he reveals to Peter, watch, how he would end up actually dying for the glory of God. He reveals his plan and purpose for his life, how his death would bring the Lord glory. And now there's a couple, if you read into it, there's a thing. First of all, he says when you're older, so he's going to live longer than where he is now. But instead of Peter just drinking that in, because listen, the whole key to life is not just knowing Jesus, it's following Jesus. You hear what I said? I mean, it's oftentimes Jesus says, follow me, follow me. So he tells Jesus, follow me. He tells Peter, follow me. So what does Peter do as Jesus reveals this? Jesus lets Peter know not only God's plan, but just keep following him. And instead of Peter drinking in it, he turns back, watch this, and he points to John. And he says, well, what about him? And one of the things Jesus says to him, listen, he says, what does that have to do with you? You follow me. So why do I share that? Listen, we don't need to compare, judge, or criticize anyone else's calling, walk, or ministry. Do you hear what I'm saying? Jesus has called us to follow him. But so often we want to turn back and see what someone else is doing or not doing, and there's a place and purpose as a disciple maker, but ultimately God just wants us to follow him. Amen? So don't get sidetracked by what's going on in other people's lives. And why do I share that? Because he said, what's that got to do with you? You follow me? I remember back in the days, maybe 25 years ago, I was teaching Bible study at Houston Baptist University. And we'd meet in the student center, and it got pretty large. We had over about 90 students, and it was an informal, you know, wasn't really on the schedule, but students just kept coming. It kept growing. And in that group, I had some very strong Christians, some not so strong, some that weren't believers. It was people from all walks, very diverse and even multicultural. But I had some really, really strong and even dominant believers that always wanted to do intense or even radical things for Christ. And I'll never forget the day, and I'll let them share. And there were two different groups. This was on Tuesday, and that Saturday, excuse me, one was Friday night and one was Saturday. Two groups were going to do something. On Friday night, and I remember so distinctly, there was a group about 10 or 12 of the students. They were going, well, you've heard of Lakewood Church. Before Lakewood Church, it was the Compact Center. Before the Compact Center, it was the Summit. And this happened to be when it was still the Summit. And I don't know the name of the group, but there was a pretty heavy, dark band coming in. A big rock band that did stuff with Satan stuff and all that kind of stuff. So these 10 or 12 students, they had a desire to go and to do a Jericho march around the Summit that night. Just to plead the blood, pray for them, whatever they want to do. I said, you know, if God tells you, then go. And there was another group, Saturday morning, they were going down to an abortion clinic just to do a private protest, to pray and actually try and reach out to the ladies that were going in there. Now, both of the leaders of these groups were very intense as they made their announcements. So much so, if you didn't go, you felt a little guilty or even condemned. You understand what I'm saying? Because watch, this is going to help you. And I'll never forget, it was after we were done, and one of the young girls, she happened to be a freshman, very precious in the Lord, and she came up to me in tears. I said, what is wrong? She said, well, I know they're doing the Jericho March, and I know they're doing the thing for the boy, and I agree with both of those, but she just started weeping. She says, I don't think I'm supposed to go. She said, the Lord spoke to me that I just need to stay home and pray for both groups. And how many of you know that's probably what God wanted her to do? Amen? So watch, because listen very carefully. Oftentimes, especially in a leader type or someone that has that kind of gifting, the Lord speaks to them. And yes, they can cast a vision, but if they try to, watch this, impart into you that's your calling, you can start walking in guilt or condemnation. You understand what I'm saying? Because ultimately, God wants to get his gospel out. Amen? And he may call you to pray. He may call you to give. He may call you to run the camera, the sound, take care of the children. How many of you know that God has a part for all of us? Amen? So we need to be sensitive enough to know what the Lord, and we're going to talk about that. Because oftentimes, we can be led astray. And for instance, in 1 Kings chapter 13, very interesting gentleman. He's the king, Jeroboam. Now, if you remember, Solomon, as he's dying, he's going to let Rehoboam be his son, be the next king. Rehoboam was a real jerk, and so the kingdom is split. And watch this. Jeroboam gets the 10 tribes. And now watch this. And God speaks to Jeroboam. God gives Jeroboam an awesome opportunity where God wants to establish his kingdom. But Jeroboam ended up being a jerk too. And I won't get into details. And he builds these pagan altars. And God speaks to a man from, I think it was a young man from Bethel. And he's a young prophet. And the Lord speaks to him. And he says to go to Jeroboam and prophesy what I tell you to prophesy. So watch this picture. Okay, I need one volunteer, just one volunteer. Okay, come, you can be king. Okay, so I want you right here at the altar. And you have a whole entourage, but I won't have y'all get up. So I mean, he's the king, all right? So everybody's with him. So watch. This prophet comes in, and he starts to prophesy. And he prophesies not just to Jeroboam, but to the altar. And watch what he prophesies, that God is going to raise up a young man named Josiah from the line of David. And watch this. He will come in and he will not only destroy, but he will burn the bones of the priests that are doing these pagan altars. You understand what I'm saying? And he's prophesying all this gloom and doom darkness because the people have gone away from the Lord. And now you realize this is a king and he has an entourage. This is just a little young prophet guy strolling into town. And then he says, and as a sign, God is going to have this altar split, and the ashes are going to pour forth. Now, you better hear from God, amen? So what does the king do? Raise your hand, just point to me and look back there and say, seize him. Louder, they got to hear you. Say, seize him. So did you watch what's this? So he's telling his entourage, no, you got to keep your hand up. This is real important. He says, seize him. So here's this prophet, and all of a sudden, as he says, seize him, the altar splits and ashes come forth, just like the prophet had just spoken. And not only that, excuse me, because this is important, the king's hand is withered and stayed. He can't pull his hand back. So all of a sudden he knows, okay, this guy's for real. He's heard from God. So, right, wouldn't you agree he's heard from God? And now the king says, oh, would you pray to your God that I would be healed? And he does. And his hand is healed. He can bring it back. And the king is so amazed. Watch what he says. He says, I want you to come back to the palace. I want to reward. I want to give you food and drink. Watch this. Listen to what the prophet says. It's really important. He says, I cannot. The Lord spoke to me to come and prophesy and to not even eat or drink in this place, and not even return the same way that I came. So he refuses the king's offer, and he keeps going. Did the young man hear from God? Would you say yes? I mean, there was a sign. So he goes off, and watch this. He takes off, and then there were several people there when this took place. And there happened to be two sons. Okay, you can be seated here for a moment. Okay, he's going to be a different character in a second. So watch. So watch. Two of the sons go back to their father in town. And their father is an older prophet. And the son said, and I'm ad-libbing, oh, dad, this prophet, young man, he prophesied it. And the ashes and the, God, dad, it was so awesome. You should have been. And the dad says, which way did he go? And they told him what way. So he says, saddle my donkey. So the old prophet gets on his donkey and he rides out. Watch this. And he rides out and he goes out and he sees a young man sitting under a tree. It happened to be the young prophet. Watch this. And he says, are you the young prophet from Bethel? And he goes, yes, I am. Watch this very carefully. He says, I want you to come to my home. I want to give you food and drink. Now, he had already heard from God, right? So what does he say? No, I cannot. Why? Because the Lord spoke to me, not only to prophesy, but to not eat or drink in this place, but to not even return the same way that I came. So he's obeying God, right? Now watch this very carefully. The older prophet, watch what he says. I too am a prophet. Watch this. And an angel of the Lord came to me and told me to get you and bring you back to my house to give you food and drink. So what does the young prophet do? He attends and walks back. He goes back with the old prophet. Now, let me ask you something. Is he making a good choice or a bad choice? Well, I'm an old prophet. I had an angel of the Lord come to me. But you know what the next sentence says? Actually, it's in the parentheses right next to it. It says this prophet was lying. It's right there in the Bible. He was lying. So he goes back. He sits down to eat. While they're eating, the word of the Lord comes through the old prophet that just lied. And he rebukes him for disobeying God, and because he's come back to eat where he shouldn't come back to eat. And listen, he says, and you will not be buried in your father's tomb. So he finishes eating. He gets off. He takes off with his donkey, gets a little ways down the road. A lion comes out, kills him, and the lion, the dead body, and the donkey are just sitting there. And the word spread real fast. And the older prophet said, I know who it is. It's the younger prophet. And he rode out, took the young man who was now dead, and buried him in his tomb. Yet he told his sons, bury me in the same tomb, because the word he spoke will come to pass. Okay, go ahead and be seated. I have no greater desire than to finish the assignment that God has on my life while I'm here. And there'll be many voices that will rise up to try to steal and rob that from you. And there'll be godly voices. There'll be anointed. Listen, we ultimately, when I stand before God, watch this. When I stand before God and God says, why? And if I say, God will say, listen, we have to answer to God for ourselves. Amen. So listen, this is so important. So, and gosh, I had so much more. I can't believe I got off on all that. Okay, So let me just jump to this. How do you know if you're following God? How do you know if you're walking the path, the journey that God has for you? So help me out. I'd like a little feedback. I mean, because either you're there or you want to be there. So can we get a little input? How do you know that you're walking in the will of God, or how do you know to walk in the will of God? Help me out. Any ideas, any thoughts? I know you do. Signs. Awesome. So signs, maybe supernatural signs, maybe dreams or visions. God has used that in the Old Testament, yes, and even in the New Testament. How else? If you don't get a sign, how do you know? What do you do? Where do you go? Okay, maybe possible routes that God doesn't want you to go. So how do you actually get instruction on where to go? Listen. Let me just share more. And I'm going to turn to it real fast because I want you to see something along the lines. I know I read Acts 20, but I'm going to jump down. You know, that's where one of my life verses, Acts 20, 24, where Paul says, my life is worth nothing to me unless I use it to finish the work assigned me by the Lord Jesus, the work of telling others the good news about the wonderful grace of God. And I don't have it marked in here, but I know this area so well. In Acts 21, watch this. Paul takes off, and God had already spoken to him where to go. Watch this. The next stop after leaving Tyre and Ptolemais, where we greeted the brothers and sisters and stayed for one day. The next day, we went on to Caesarea and stayed in the home, watch this, of Philip the Evangelist. Say Philip the Evangelist. Okay, this is a man of God. He's used mightily in the Word of God. I mean, signs, wonders, and miracles. It's pretty awesome. He's the one that baptized the Ethiopian eunuch, and then God translated him. That's a pretty awesome place to walk, right? And watch this. One of the seven men who had been chosen to distribute food. He had four unmarried daughters who had the gift of prophecy. So this is a gifted family. Several days later, a man named Agabus, who also had the gift of prophecy, arrived from Judea. So these are anointed prophets with the gift of the word of the Lord. Listen carefully. He came over. He took Paul's belt. Okay, I hope my pants stay on. Watch this. He took Paul's belt. Watch this. And he bound it on his own feet and his hands with it. And then he said, the Holy Spirit. So he heard from God, right? He said, the Holy Spirit. You can't say the Holy Spirit said unless he said. If you do, you're in trouble. If you say it and God didn't speak, you understand what he's saying? He says, The same belt, the owner of this belt, watch this, declared, the Holy Spirit declares, so shall the owner of this belt be bounded by the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem and turned over to the Gentiles. when we heard this, they heard the word of the Lord. We and the local believers all begged Paul not to go to Jerusalem. Did you hear what was just said? God has spoken to Paul. You will go to Jerusalem. He meets a prophet, evangelist, prophecies. They take out the belt and it says, the Holy Spirit says, this is what's going to happen. And then they added their own interpretation or desire. Then they said, don't go. God already told Paul what was going to happen. So listen to what Paul says. He says, why all this weeping? You're breaking my heart. I'm ready not only to be jailed at Jerusalem, but even to die for the sake of the Lord Jesus. When it was clear we could not persuade him, we gave up and said, and this is the key, the Lord's will be done. I believe that's every one of our desires. Listen, Jesus said, my sheep know my voice, and the voice of a stranger they will not follow. It doesn't say you will not hear. We will hear many voices. God wants us to follow his voice. So let me ask you one more time. How do we know the voice of the Lord? How do we know it's the word of God? We heard some. And let me tell you, the number one way is the word of God itself. Amen? Listen, this has to be your anchor and your plumb line. It's the word of God. This is how you understand or can interpret the voice of the Lord, is knowing the word of God. And there's someone have a Bible? If you will turn to me, 2 Timothy chapter 3. As he turns to 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, I'm going to read from Psalm 19. And there's hundreds of verses on this. These are just a couple of my favorites. But watch this. Watch what the word of the Lord does. Watch this. It revives the soul. It makes me wise, brings joy to my heart, gives insight for living, lasts forever. Watch this. They are more desirable than gold, even finest gold, sweeter than honey, even dripping honey drippings from the comb. By them, watch this. By them am I your servant. I'm warned. Watch what the Hebrew says. I am warned through the word of God. I am warned. I am reminded. I am illuminated. And I am instructed. Do you hear that? You cannot get too much of the word of God in you. You want to know God's plan and purpose, you have to have the word of God in you. Amen? Even to know what to pray for. Jesus said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you can ask whatever you want and I'll do it for you. But the key is having the word of God in you. Amen? So 2 Timothy 3:16, can you do it loudly, sir?
All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness.
Did you hear that? Teaching, reproof, instruction, for training. The word, so everybody say this, say the word of God. Okay, and there's more. And now there's some key things that will, watch this, in the word of God. The first thing God wants you to do is to be in Christ, so it's to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Amen? That's the key. And then I love this. Is your heart right? Remember, I've shared about walking in integrity of heart, because if your heart's right and you go down the wrong path, God will intervene to show you the right path. Remember Abram and Sarai? And he tells Abimelech, King Abimelech, that she's my sister. He takes Sarah into his harem, and God speaks to the king, you are a dead man. That woman is married. And this pagan king not only hears, but now has a conversation with the living God. God, would you kill an innocent man? I took her out of the integrity of my heart. They said they were brother and sister. And God says, I know you took her out of the integrity of your heart. That's why I've kept you from sinning with her. Listen, if your heart's right, and you make a wrong choice, God can intervene to show you the right path. Amen? So the integrity of heart. Okay, so a couple of other key ones. Peace. Say peace. Say it again. Peace. That's shalom. Colossians 3:15, it says, let the peace of God rule in your heart. If you read the Hebrew, it's pretty awesome. It says, let the peace of God, that union that comes through knowing Christ, watch this, let it act as an umpire, making all decisions that arise in your mind, watch this, and settling with finality. What's that mean? The peace of God. Listen, have you ever started to do something, say something, and inside you knew you weren't supposed to say, do, or go there? Anybody ever been there? And it's real easy to squelch or put aside and go do our own thing, and then later we go, oh, I should have listened to the peace of God. Amen? You know what? If you don't know what the peace of God is, you know when you're not in the peace of God. We've all been there. We've gone the wrong way, wrong person, wrong. Anybody ever take a multiple choice test? You ever do this? I used to be real good at multiple choice. Oh, A, 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 eight. There's no way he's going to be four. He's gonna... So I put a little mark here over the side. Okay, I'll come back to that one. And I go, come back, and I come back later and go, eight. No, I bet it's B. So I put B, and then I get my test back, and I go, oh, I knew it was A. Anybody been there? So listen, that verse, that peace, say peace. So let the peace of God rule in your heart. Let it act as an umpire. And then, you know, very precious, it's most powerful, it's the Holy Spirit. Say the Holy Spirit. I'm going to read, if I can, it's in 1 John chapter 2. I want you to listen carefully before we close in prayer. And it's going to sound out of context due to time, but I want you to catch this, and then I'll explain to it. Verse 24, so you must remain faithful to what you've been taught from the beginning. If you do, you will remain in fellowship with the Son and with the Father. And in this fellowship, we enjoy the eternal life he promised us. Listen to verse 26. I am writing these things to warn you about those who want to lead you astray. But you have received the Holy Spirit, and he lives within you, so you don't need anyone to teach you what is true. I believe your King James says the anointing. So watch this. It lives within you, so you don't need anyone to teach you what is true. For the Spirit teaches you everything you need to know, and what he teaches is true. It is not a lie. So just as he taught you, remain in fellowship with Christ. So watch this. The anointing says you don't need anyone to teach you. Well, it doesn't say you don't need teachers. Watch this. It's talking about false prophets and those who want to lead you astray. When someone tells you, oh, you need to go there, or you need to do this, or you need to come back to my house to eat and drink, you understand what I'm saying? The anointing, the Holy Spirit within you will say, no. You understand what I'm saying? You have the Holy Spirit within you, and he will clearly make known his will and what is not his will. You understand that? So you don't, I better go talk and ask someone. And if there's a possibility, because wise counsel is good. But listen, many times it's a moment, like at that moment, that young prophet, he had to say yes or no. But if he had already listened to what he'd heard and knew, he wouldn't have gone. So I want you to know what's so awesome is God never leaves you. He never forsakes you. And if your pastor's not there, or your friend, or your counselor, or mentor, or discipler, you have the anointing within you. And at that moment, he will tell you very clearly which way to go or not to go. Amen? I remember my pastor who's in heaven now, John Osteen. I remember someone told him he needed to fast for 10 days. So he fasted for 10 days. At the end of the 10 days, someone said, did you have any visions? He said, oh, yeah, pizza and hamburgers. But God didn't tell him to fast. A man told him to fast. It's just a learning, isn't it? But I remember when a gentleman came to him and he said, watch this, he says, Pastor Osteen, this prophet came to me and he told me I needed to go to Africa. And he asked Pastor John, he says, what do you think? He says, well, if you go, make sure you take that man with you. And he goes, why? He says, well, since he told you you need to go, he's the only one who can tell you when to come back. So what is he saying? Listen, we need to hear from God for ourselves, amen? So in the meantime, what do we do? Listen, hunger and thirst, stay in the Word of God. Stay in the presence of the Lord. And watch this. And if you're not sure what to do, this is what you do. Be faithful right where God has you. Did you hear what I said? Be faithful right where God has you. As God told Elijah to go anoint Elisha, who's going to be the next prophet, and have a double portion. Elisha was Elisha in the temple fasting? No, Elisha was in the field behind 12 yoke of oxen. He was being faithful to take care of his family business. You hear what I'm saying? Yeah. When God tells the prophet to go to Jesse's house, Samuel tells Samuel to go to Jesse's house to anoint the next king. Watch this. Jesse brings out 7 sons, and none of them are king. Do you have anyone else? Well, the young guy out of date. Listen. David missed the meeting with the man of God, but David was faithful to be where God called him to be. He didn't manipulate, con, or maneuver to try and be there with the prophet. Listen, God knows right where you are. You don't need to rub shoulders. You need to abide in Christ. And God says, Samuel says, we won't sit till he comes, and he comes, and he's anointed king. So listen, you can see, even Peter, he was just fishing, taking care of business. So be faithful where you are, doing what you know to do. And if you don't have a specific word from the Word of God, then do the written word. Walk in love. Share the gospel. Give. You understand what I'm saying? Listen, God doesn't hide his purpose from us. He hides his purpose for us. But we have to do our part to find it out and walk in it. Amen? Amen? Is this okay? Is this good? So listen, God has an amazing plan assignment for every one of our lives. And the neat thing is, even with all our junk and baggage and failures, God has still chosen you and me for such a time as this. That's a pretty awesome God, right? So nothing about our lives surprises God. He knows the package that he's getting. But he's chosen us. So let us do our part to walk in the calling he has for our lives. So if we're in the Word of God, if we're in prayer, if we follow peace, keep integrity of heart, listen, be faithful right where you are, and God will watch. God will take you where you are to where he wants you to be. We don't need to so much hunt for it as much as just follow Christ. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your love, the lavish love you have for us, your faithfulness, how you never give up on us. And Lord, the grace and mercy, how you've called each one of us for such a time as this. And Lord, ultimately, your desire is our desire is, as you said, follow me. Lord, we just want to follow you. We so want to follow and abide in you, Lord, that on that day when we see your face, our desire, I believe, for each one of us is to hear you say, well done. And Lord, I thank you along that path. You don't count how many times we fall as much as how many times we get back up. Lord, you never saw the ones that fell as failures. You always saw them as learners as long as they kept getting back up. And Lord, I'm so reminded when Stephen's preaching in Acts and he talks about how you talk about David, how David would do everything I called him to do. Lord, all of us can name things that you didn't call David to do, but you never brought that up. You never brought that up in the new covenant. Because you don't just cover, but you take away our sins. And if we'll get back up with a broken heart and desire to follow you, God, we can follow you and finish our race and hear you say, well done. So, Lord, I ask that you would seal this in our hearts this day, that you have plans for each one of our lives. Lord, you've given us an anointing to know your voice and to follow you, especially when others try to deceive us. And Lord, I pray for this church, for each individual. I don't know everyone here, but I know they've heard the gospel. If they haven't done the first part of entering relationship with you through Christ as their Lord, as their Savior, may they, even just under your breath right now, say, Jesus, I need you. I have sinned. I believe you've taken my sin. I believe God raised you from the dead. I repent, and Jesus, I need you. I'm asking you to come and be the Lord of my life. Jesus, not just my Lord, but I want to follow you every day of my life. Lord, would you seal this in our hearts? And Lord, I pray that each one of us daily would say, Lord, fill me with your Spirit and give me the power to grow with you and to follow you every day of my life. And Lord, whether it's behind the camera, whether it's with the children, whether it's at the podium or out on the streets, you've called each one of us to make a difference in people's lives for the kingdom of God and for eternity. And Lord, as we walk in that calling and assignment, we see, as you did with Paul, with wrecked ships and snakes, you protected him. And Lord, 3 months later, you provided for him to fulfill his journey. So Lord, we see that not only will there be protection, but there'll be provision to fulfill the plan and course you have for each one of our lives. Lord, may this come to pass and bring you glory and honor in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said amen and amen. God bless you.